Welcome to Impact Farming, where we introduce you to the people and ideas that will have a massive impact on your farming operation. Brought to you by Farm Marketer. Sit down, start the engine, and let's roll with today's show.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Impact Farming. On today's show, I have a fantastic guest with me. I have JP Gervais, who is the Vice President and Chief Agricultural Economist for Farm Credit Canada. Welcome, JP.
Hey, it's a pleasure to be here.
Excellent. So I am very excited to be having this conversation about interest rates. I have had a burning question in my mind for so long, and I think interest rates is one of those things for farmers. We as farmers have so much on our minds at all points, and you know what? Lending interest rates is so very, very important because you don't get far without lending these days. But in the scheme of a farmer's day-to-day, I mean, it's just probably a bit of a passing thought, right?
No, I totally get it, for sure. I mean, I've met so many farm operators and farmers and producers and owners of businesses that have production risk top of mind, number one thing. And for sure, you know, I always say that producers like to be out in the field more than in the office, and that's fair. Totally. I mean, that's my job, be in the office, and that's our job at FCC, to be in the office, frankly. And so that's fair. But I do believe that, you know, if you look at the different risks on a farm, I mean, financial risk is one of the risks that I think as a farm owner you have to be aware of, and you have to have some sort of a plan going forward.
Excellent. So I would love to get into JP's mind and ask a few questions today. And before I dive into my burning question, I want to throw a few terms out there and get you to define them for our audience. Fixed, variable, open, etc., etc. There's so many terms out there. Can you speak to that?
Yeah, I think the basic point, first of all, is to get the difference between fixed and variable. So fixed is where I am going to lock in a rate for any period of time. So I can go fixed rate for a one-year type term or a fixed rate for a five-year term.
Okay.
I can do a same thing as committing to a variable rate for 1 year or 5 years. The difference is that this variable rate is going to be based off some benchmark interest rate, which in most cases would be what we call prime rate. And prime rate would be attached to what the Bank of Canada set as their overnight rate, their guidance in terms of their own benchmark rate. So you would be paying an interest rate, or you would be charged an interest rate that's function of prime plus or minus some adjustment factor that depends on the size of the loan, the sector you're in, your history, and so on. So I think the main topic is or the main point is to fully understand the difference between fixed and variable, and then you can think of term going short term, long term, 1 year versus 5 years. But everything's possible. It starts with, do I lock in a rate for a given period of time, or do I let it float and be exposed to fluctuations in interest rates?
Okay. Perfect. So my burning question and how it came about, I'm going to say probably about 10, 15 years ago, I was at a conference at a round table, probably 8, 10 individuals. I'm not even sure if it was agriculture at that point. And there was a gentleman there whose wife was a fairly prominent lender. And somebody asked him about fixed and variable rates. And he relayed from his wife's knowledge, he said, when his wife studied it, over the course of time, the ups and downs, variable rate always seemed to be cheaper. Mm-hmm. Can you speak to that?
Well, that's true. With this caveat, which I really do think it's important to understand, is if we've been in an environment in Canada where interest rates have been declining for 25 years and more, early 90s. So we've had interest rates go up and down for 25 years, but the big picture over the long term, over the last 25 years, has been interest rates coming down. We had, in the spring of 2017, the lowest borrowing costs on record in Canada ever.
Oh, wow.
So on average. average. So we've had interest rates come down. So this is why when you do the variable versus fixed and say, well, if I go and fix my interest rate for 5 years, I'm going to lose money compared to a variable rate option. And the reason is that we've been in this environment where interest rates have been declining. So at the end of the 5 years, when you're renewing at a much lower, not necessarily much lower, but certainly lower interest rates than what you signed on to begin with. Whereas if you go variable, then you've been moving all the way through these 5 years at the same pace as the prime interest rate, for example. So okay. That's the reason why variables seem to outweigh, so to speak, the benefits of going fixed. But having said that, that works in a declining rate environment.
That is the key right there. And I remember sitting at my computer one time, Anthony and myself were sitting down, we were getting ready to take out a loan, and I was having that conversation come back to me, and then I was playing with the rates on the online calculator and going, fix, variable, should I fix this in? And I didn't quite know. So I love that you shared that. It depends on the environment.
Yeah, and it's really a question, and obviously I've been asked a question, I don't know how many times since I've been with FCC. And really at the end of the day, and nobody likes to hear this, but it's a question of risk appetite. What kind of appetite do I have to be exposed to some risk? And it depends on a number of things. Where I'm at in my overall plan for my farm, right? What kind of stage I'm at? Am I looking at transitioning pretty soon, or am I just getting started? Am I looking at expansion? Am I looking at a more mature business where I have a lot of that debt paid down and so I can take on a little bit more risk, okay. Right? So this is a reason why you need to sit down with somebody. You need to understand your financial ratios, and you need to understand first and foremost the amount of risk you're taking on. If you're okay with being 100% all your debt, 100% of your debt being priced at a variable rate, absolutely. I don't think there's anything wrong with that as long as you recognize what you expose yourself to. Okay. And really, frankly, it's a decision about where this, your own operation as well as your own preferences or attitude or towards risk, right? Yeah. So can you, you know, be comfortable with, you know, interest rates moving up or the likelihood that interest rates are moving up? If just as the hearing about interest rates, the likelihood of interest rates going up prevents you from sleeping at night, maybe I would argue that maybe that's, you know, that's where you have to reconsider that risk appetite. And it doesn't mean that you have to go all in on one option versus the other. You can have a mix of, you know, I'm going to have 80% of my debt priced at a fixed rate over a 5-year term, and I'm going to have some other part of my debt being exposed to fluctuations in interest rates, being short-term, so on. There's lots of different combinations. You just have to be comfortable with understanding how much exposure do you have to that financial risk, right? Because at the end of the day, when we talk about interest rates, it's talking about financial risk.
Excellent. And to expand on that, when I was sitting down looking and playing with those numbers online to set the scenario, it would have been for a cattle loan, a fairly nice sum of money over a short period of time, so high payments. And we were at a point where we wanted to expand our operation. But as we know, sometimes in agriculture, commodity prices go crazy. Sure. So I was probably feeling a little bit uncomfortable with the cattle prices and go, okay, if I could lock this in, no matter what happens with the cattle price, I know where that is. But I really like how you said, well, high level, we need to look at where interest rates are and use that as an index. So the next question I wanted to roll into then, and I know we spoke about it in a previous episode that we had done about farmland values. So we have been in a great period where interest rates have been low.
Yep.
And can you maybe touch on what you've seen the last little while with the jump in interest rates in 17? What do you think in 18? And kind of set the scenario a little bit there.
We've had borrowing costs go up by about 125 basis points on average in Canada over the last 14 to 16 months. So depending again what type of products you're looking at, you know, because rates are not going to move all at the same time with what the Bank of Canada does. The Bank of Canada does have a big impact on the variable rate you're going to pay, but if you're looking at locking in an interest rate, that's going to be a function of what the Bank of Canada does as well as what the bond markets do. The bond markets in Canada, because when you borrow money from your financial institution, what your financial institution is really doing is borrowing money itself to lend it back to you, right? So the cost of the funds that the financial institution face do have an impact on the interest rate that you're going to pay for those 3-year fixed rate product or 5-year fixed rate product.
Okay.
So there's a lot of different variables. So this is why it's never a good thing to really try to time the market. we have right now the Bank of Canada doing another interest rate announcement on October 24th. The market's telling us, the bond markets are telling us right now that the probability of seeing another rate increase is really high.
Okay.
We're over 90% right now, is really high. So it's almost as if, I'm not going to say too late, because it's never too late to do anything, but it's not necessarily about that next rate announcement on October 24th. It's really about the next few months, or the potential few ones, right? So there's going to be another rate announcement in December. There's going to be another rate announcement in January. And given that now the uncertainty about the North American Free Trade Agreement has been lifted, there's less of a cloud over the Canadian economy. If you look at the probability of seeing a rate hike in January, for example, of 2019, we're like around 50% of the time that we're shooting this interview. So there is a likelihood that interest rates are going to keep on increasing. And as well, this is perhaps a big adjustment for farm operations, because we're starting from a very low level. So it doesn't take much to double, basically, the interest expenses that operations have or face, right?
Yeah.
So I think it's definitely has to be on the mind. And I really like your example about, because you brought up the idea of hedging, because you're locking in prices for cattle and so on, right? Managing financial risk is not just about choosing the right term structure and the right type of loan for your operation, but it's also about everything else as well. For example, right, I can be okay maybe by letting some of my debt priced under a variable rate, knowing that maybe I'm going to have to pay more on that debt if rates go up, if I have certainty about what I'm going to get from a revenue standpoint. We don't want to look at all that risk management in silos, and that I think is really important for our operations to get a very clear picture of where they stand in terms of their business, not just on the financial side, but also on the marketing side, production side. Do I need to fully insure my crop? And what are those decisions that I need to make to make sure that I expose my operation to the right level of risk that I'm comfortable with?
Okay, excellent. Wise words. I have a question for you, and I'm sure it is on any farmer's mind, especially ones that have been farming for a long time, that have lived through it, and the younger generation that have heard about it. And I know we can't hold you to this because nobody can foresee the future, but back in the 80s, we had interest rates that went up to 20%.
Mm-hmm.
And I know when I sit down and sign my name on one more loan, that's in my mind, and especially how I got into this topic of fixed versus variable. Again, we cannot hold you to this, but do you think we'll ever see those 20% interest rates again?
It'd be really surprising to me. I'm not saying this is not possible. For sure it is possible. Nobody can guarantee that we're never going to get back there. But let me tell you why I don't think it is possible. Because we have a totally different setting and policy environment around interest rates in Canada. Right now, it's all about managing inflation. And we had at the time, when interest rates shot up to, you mentioned 20%, we had at the time no clear understanding of what the damage that inflation could do to an economy. And so this is why at one point we woke up and said, oh, wait a second, we have this runaway inflation and we need to act. And we need to act fast, otherwise we're just gonna lose track of the economy. And then runaway inflation is not a good thing for an economy, just like no inflation is not a good thing either. So we have to have, the target for the Bank of Canada is to have inflation between 1% and 3%, with the average being 2%. And as long as you're not deviating too much from that, the bank is gonna be okay. I think we have a much better understanding of how markets work. Having said that, we're not immune to financial crisis, as we've seen in 2008. We had another big financial crisis in 1999 with the Asian financial crisis. We haven't seen any of that, or very little of that, in Canada. But like I said, we're not immune to financial crisis, so we're not immune to also interest rates moving up. But I do think that the rate increases that we're likely to see are going to continue to be gradual. That's going to be made at a pace manageable by most businesses. as long as we have a planning horizon that is longer than just the next couple of months, right? And I think that's the one thing I see as something that I would advise, is to have that long-term planning horizon. Even though you're not looking to make any type of significant investment, have that long-term planning horizon to make sure that you understand the risks. Like I said, unlikely, but you know, certainly in the realm of possibility. But like I said, I don't think this interest rates would jump back up to 20% as we've seen in the past.
Okay, excellent. That might make me sleep a little nicer at night.
And as long as you have that good risk management in place. And so, absolutely.
Yes. And I know we've touched on it at a few different points throughout our conversation, but let's say Tracy Burnett, the farmer, sitting across from you right now, and I'm saying, hey, JP, I have a cattle operation, whatever kind of operation. I want to make sure that I have a strong financial risk management plan. Mm-hmm. What kind of words of wisdom would you share with me and other farmers?
Yeah, don't do it by yourself, first of all. So surround yourself. Have that CEO type mentality. I like to point out that a CEO is not an expert at everything.
No.
You know, it's somebody that, or he or she is somebody that surrounds himself or herself with folks that know about some very specific components of their business, right? So on the financial side, surround yourself with somebody you trust, and then you develop a relationship. Know some basic financial ratios as well. Understand that if things don't move the way that you expected, understand how your debt repayment capacity evolves, right? Am I going to be able to meet that debt those debt obligations, even if commodity prices come down by X percent, even if I if my crop is 10% smaller than what I expected to begin with, you know, at the beginning of the year, those type of risks, right? So just have this risk understanding of risk, understanding of those basic financial ratios. I always say that first line of defense is your working capital, right? So what is the state of your liquidity in your farm? Mm-hmm. And be able to understand how much pressure it puts on your cash flows and interest rates go up, or if commodity prices come down. I think it's part of a holistic type view of the farm that you have to have when you're thinking about financial risk.
Excellent. That is great advice indeed. Thank you for that. I would like to thank you so much for this talk.
Pleasure.
It was great. Again, that question of fixed versus variable has been burning in my mind for so long. So thank you.
Pleasure.
And I know you said there's another interest rate announcement coming October 24th. Where is the best place as Canadian producers to keep up to date to find out more about this type of information?
Yeah. So the one thing I like to point out is that you know, the media, for good reasons, for sure, you know, they tend to spend quite a bit of time talking about the Bank of Canada decisions.
Yeah.
But as I said, the one on October 24th is mostly well anticipated by the financial markets. So I won't expect the markets, you know, whether we're talking about the exchange rate, the value of the Canadian dollar is influenced by interest rates, which has an impact on the price you're going to get as a producer, right? So all these things are connected. I don't expect the interest rate decision of October 24th to have a big impact on any of these variables. What I expect, though, is what the Bank of Canada is going to say about the next few months is going to have an impact already.
Okay.
So it's always about the next one, right? So monitor what's going on for October 24th. You can check on our website, fcc.ca. There's an acknowledge section where you can find economics. Go to our section of the website. We're certainly going to be on top of the trend, and when it comes to interest rate, that's for sure. It's on the mind of a lot of our producers for sure. But other than that, I think, you know, it's to go beyond the headlines and say, all right, interest rate just went up. But what about that 2 months from now? And I think that's the one thing that producers need to keep in mind. It's always about the next one, not necessarily the one that we're talking about right now.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for joining us.
Pleasure. Thanks so much for the invite.
Thank you.
You've been listening to Impact Farming. For more great episodes and articles designed to help you manage and grow your farming operation, head on over to farmmarketer.com. Don't forget to sign up while you're there. We will see you on the next episode.